Well, greetings, everyone. My message this afternoon is called Counting the Cost Continued. We often talk about the notion of counting the cost as a precursor to discipleship. We talk about counting the cost when we're explaining Christianity to someone. We talk about counting the cost in the context of if you're going to follow Jesus, it means thus and thus, that he has these kinds of expectations of your lives, and these kinds of requirements of obedience, and this laying down of your life in order to be his. And that's a really important process. It's a really pivotal moment in someone choosing to become a Christian. But that's not what I want to talk about today. What I want to talk about today is, after that decision has been made, are we continuing to count the cost? Is that process ongoing? Do we continue to think about what it means and what it costs me personally and us corporately? Do we continue to count the cost of what it means to be disciples of Jesus? And I know that this happens in our lives from time to time when we have to repent of something or God's dealing with something, but the attitude of being a cost counter, of really accurately assessing what it is that it means to me and it costs me to be a disciple of Jesus, those are some of the things I want to talk about today. Why don't we have a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this afternoon. We thank you for this opportunity to be together in Jesus' name. And Father, more than anything, we thank you for the example that Jesus laid, that he was a forerunner and a forebearer. He was the firstborn of the dead, that he showed a way for his people to walk. I pray, Father, that you'd help us to examine those things closely, to learn of him, to emulate him. And I pray you'd use this time to set our hearts like a flint, like he set his face to go to Jerusalem. We ask for your blessing on this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. I want to read for a little bit here. Second Timothy chapter 3. Starting in verse 1, we're going to read this chapter into the next a little. So, chapter 3, verse 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be, now remember this was written 2,000 years ago. So whatever the end is, we're at least 2,000 years closer to it than the writer of these words. In the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds reprobate concerning the faith, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came into me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. I charge therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and in his kingdom, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me, for Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Take Mark, bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Antichicus have I sent to Ephesus. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when thou comest, bring with thee, and the books, but especially the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works, of whom be thou ware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching that might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So there's some powerful words in those verses that we just read. It's interesting to me that this description of the last time, this description which is very fitting to our day, I don't know that it wasn't fitting to any day before us, but there's certainly things here that I pick out in chapter 3 that seem uniquely suited to our cultural environment. Men should be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents. That always strikes me. You know, the notion that it is the common course of development that children should rebel against their parents, that's ubiquitous now. It's assumed that when children get to a certain age, they will rebel against their parents. That is an unholy and an unrighteous and a foreign notion to God's ideas about what a family is. There is no expectation in my home, and neither should there be in yours, that we will go through a period of rebellion with our children. That's an aberration. That's an indictment against our age, not an indictment of family. You know, without natural affections, these things are just ubiquitous in our day, and especially watching the election for the next president and seeing all of these things encompassed. I mean, if it's not in one of them, it's in the other. This horrible, horrible misconduct and misdeeds. So we can say, at least for our day, we're living in this. We see this all around us. We see this abounding around us. And so in the light of living in this kind of environment that's being described here, there's some prescribed action that the church should be doing. Since the day is like this, then you should be like this. In Paul's day, encountering these sins, and it's good to know that all of our fathers who came before us encountered these things in their own way, and they left an example. Paul's example was his persecutions, and it's all the major places he goes. He can list them off. Antioch, Iconium, Lystra. And then this passage that I'm sure has troubled every faithful soul. All who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And this is one of those verses that is... it has a strange effect on me. It's kind of like the opposite side of this coin is the promises of Jesus that whatever we ask in his name be granted. Like there's this, it's such a broad sweeping statement. It's so all-encompassing that these kind of verses, they kind of grab a hold of you and you think, well, what does this have to do with me? If he is saying that all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, then I have to look for it, right? Like I have to be on one side of that. Either I'm godly and receiving persecution, or it seems like if I'm not receiving persecution is the implication that I'm not godly. Now, I don't know that that's a necessary conclusion, but what I do know is that from the teaching of Jesus to the teaching of the apostles, there ought to be an earnest expectation that we are at war with the world around us. That we are living in hostile territory. That we are not here to fit in. We are not here to be comfortable. We are not here to have a good life. We are not here to be the status quo. That there is something that's supposed to stick out, and in some environments, there are some things about us that are supposed to be thorny to the world around us. There's an expected friction and agitation between the church and the world. And we know this from what John says when he says that friendship of the world is enmity with God. There's two systems at play, and they don't get along very well. There's friction and tension and persecution. I want to make some application, but let's finish looking through here, just perusing. These evil men, he says, are going to get worse and worse as time goes on. And in light of that, we're supposed to continue in the things that we've learned. There's an encouragement from Paul to Timothy here that I know you're going to face opposition. I know that this is going to be contrary to the world around you. You have to stick with the things that you've learned from God. That everything around, it's like he's warning him, everything around you is going to mitigate itself against what you know from God. Remember where you learned the things that you learned and who you learned them by, and hold fast to those faithful things. The scriptures are then mentioned as the key to his ability to endure all these things. And that's instructive to us. But then look at this where we begin chapter 4. In the light of all this wickedness, all these wicked men, this wicked system, all this sin, all this perversion, these horrible things happening, he charges Timothy before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, the judge, to preach, to be instant in season and out of season, that means ready all the time. To reprove, rebuke and exhort. Now this is kind of like kicking a hornet's nest, right? He just spent all this time telling us how wicked and how horrible and how evil the world is, how that persecutions are going to come, and then he says, now in the midst of that environment, I want you to preach, to rebuke, and to exhort. You're supposed to be, Timothy, a living challenge to that system and that sin that's around you. Don't be complacent with it. Don't get comfortable with it. Don't get used to it being in your neighborhood. Don't become desensitized to these things, but rebuke them, correct them, challenge them, stand against them. There's no place in this admonition for accepting the world as it is. We're being sold a message that with the world being so horrible, we just need to be nice to everyone, to love everybody into the kingdom, to be kind and to say how little things matter, just believe in Jesus and everything will be okay. But that's not the instruction of the apostle. When encountering sin and wickedness and defilement in the world, he says to preach and to rebuke and to exhort, to stand against the tide. But he also says to do it with all long-suffering and doctrine. And then it's kind of this Jeremiah call, you know. He tells them to preach and to rebuke and to exhort, and then he says, but they're not going to listen, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. They'll turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. He tells them to watch. He tells them to endure affliction. And in the context of enduring affliction, he's supposed to do the work of an evangelist. Do everything that you're supposed to do. And then he testifies. And this is an important part of this whole admonition, I think, because Paul is proving to Timothy that this is not a futile endeavor. That in the midst of Paul's own life, with having suffered all of his persecutions and all of his trials and all of his struggle, and as we know later here, feeling left alone, in the midst of all that, Paul says, I'm right with God. I've done what I'm supposed to do. I've been faithful. Like, it's not a far-off thing that you just keep aiming for and there's no attainable goal. Paul says by the time he's ready to wrap up his ministry, as he sits in prison, he says, I've done what I'm supposed to do. He has a confidence in what he's done and what his life has produced. Paul is sitting in a prison saying, look, young man, be faithful. I was faithful, and even though I'm looking down an executioner's axe, I've done what I'm supposed to do, and I'm ready to go. My life has been full. I've lived for a purpose, and I'm ready to go. There's no fear. There's no hesitation. I've finished my course. I've run my race. I'm afraid of how many of us don't know the course, don't know where it is we're going to or what we're supposed to be doing along the way. If Paul says, I've fought the good fight, I have finished my course, then he had to know that there was a place that he was coming from and going to, that there was a trajectory of his ministry and his life that was set and established, albeit corrected along the way. But he knew there was a purpose, he knew there was a goal, and he knew what he was pursuing. That's why he could get to where he was wanting to go. And he had this eye for the heavenly reward. Now, I read this last part because this nitty-gritty detail, I think, is we have so much. There's some beautiful theology that's written by Paul. There's some really profound concepts that he writes about. And there's some grand concepts and principles that he elucidates. But right here, there's these little pictures that are so real, so tangible, so practical, even down to his clothing, that it's worth, I think, looking at the outworkings of how some of these things worked in Paul's life. And here's what I want to highlight. he says to Timothy, come to me. And then look in verse 10. He says, for Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. And do you wonder, did Timothy say, oh, Paul, are you gossiping about Demas? Is that gossip? Is that a kind way to speak about Demas? Should you really be talking about somebody that way? Yes. Demas was an enemy to the work of Paul. And Paul had no problem expressing that exactly for what it was. Demas stood against me. He's forsaken me, and he loved this world and departed. He goes on in all these practical things to deal with these situations just as bluntly as he's facing them in his life. Nobody's with me. Everybody's walked away but Paul, but Luke. He has these instructions, these reconciliatory instructions. See, this is what I wanted to point out in these practical things with Paul. All of these things are in tension and balance. On the one hand, he's saying Demas loved the world. He departed from the faith. On the other hand, he's reconciling with John Mark. This is our only notion of the reconciliation between him and John Mark. I know there's some assumptions built in there, but they have this great parting of the ways, and now by the end of his ministry, he's saying, bring him, he's profitable to me. There's some kind of reconciliation between the two men in their ministry, which is beautiful to see. He's got these ministries going on. He's sending Tychicus to Ephesus. He's talking about all these practical things. He's still learning. That's what I take out of this. Paul, at the end of his life, he still wants his books. He still wants his parchments. He still wants to learn. He still wants to study. He still wants to engage. And then another rebuke. Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. And here again, these things strike my non-resistant ears as funny. Because if I heard somebody say this, I would ask questions, wouldn't you? Like, imagine we're sitting around after a meeting today, and one of the brothers says, yeah, that guy, he withstood me. I hope the Lord does to him what he did to me. It's pretty intense. What are we supposed to learn from that? Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Of whom be thou ware also. Beware of this guy, for he greatly withstood our words. And then he gives kind of a narration of how that went. There's another instance that's similar to this with Peter and Simon Magus. When Simon Magus says, here's money, I want to buy the Holy Ghost. I want to be able to, can I pay you so that I can do what you can do? And Peter, I don't know if you know, this is the appropriate term for this, Peter curses Simon. Thy money perish with thee also. That's a curse. And Paul says, bless, I say bless and curse not. But here we find Peter cursing this man, this Simon Magus. Thy money perish with thee. My point in all this, I'm not trying to say we should be rough and gruff with people. What I'm saying is that these things, there's not, what God's doing through the apostles is responding to the world the way it is. Like these situations, there's no right, there's no one way to deal with people. There's no one way to deal with difficulty. There's no one way to deal with trial. There's no one way to deal with adversity. That all these things are happening in real time. That there's a grace given to each of these situations to work themselves out according to the will of God. And in Alexander the coppersmith's case, it's important for Paul to warn Timothy, be careful of this guy, he is dangerous to the work. That's a valid function of that apostle's ministry in this young preacher's life, this young minister's life. But there's also this grace that is coming on the other side. So he says, may God reward him the way that he rewarded us. But then he talks about delivered on, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to him be glory. Where does it say? I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. So here within two verses, 15, he says, of whom be thou aware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. There's something about the tension of these comments that on one hand he can say, here's a warning, here's a dangerous person, here's a wicked man, and on the other hand, I hope he comes out of this on the right side. There's still a hope, even in the end. Lord, don't lay this to their charge. Just like Stephen. Stephen's being stoned, right? And he says, Lord, don't lay this to their charge. There's no desire in the apostle, even in dealing with the frankness of difficulty, the frankness of rebellious and disobedient men, of enemies of the gospel. He can be frank with that and gracious at the same time, that the two are not opposed to each other, that he can talk about situations as they are and hope that they change. He doesn't let go of that. He doesn't leave that be. The two go together. This everlasting hope that maybe this will come out on the other side. And those things are important to keep in tension. So as you can imagine, for those of you that know, this is a sensible message after having visited my friend in prison. The Oteris and my family are close friends with Ken Miller, who's in prison now, and I'm not going to go through all the details of that case for those of you who don't know, but he's a good friend of ours and he's in prison for being faithful. And he's actually facing more time now for continuing to be faithful. Faithful to his brothers, faithful to the gospel, and faithful to his king. And it's a powerful and dynamic experience to be with someone who is suffering in that moment for righteousness. I don't have a whole lot of context for that. I mean, I've seen people that will sacrifice family, and I've seen people that will, I'm very well acquainted with people who make hard decisions in regards to their relationships, in regards to not having things that they could have. I've seen a lot of people make hard decisions for the gospel, but real persecution, real actually suffering for God is a rare quality that I'm not used to. And it has an effect. I can see very clearly why the apostle adjures us to visit those in bonds, to care for them, and to remember them. Because it does something to you to be with someone who's suffering persecution. As I'm sitting across a glass partition and talking through a phone to a man who has 6 children and a wife and a ministry and a church, and not only that, but this particular man is perhaps the kindest, meekest, gentlest man that I've ever known. He's not like me. He's not gruff and rough around the edges. He's not loud and bold and potentially obnoxious. He's a very kind, meek, gentle man. And the incongruity between his gentleness and his treatment in the world system is so stark that it's almost palpable. And when I was with him, I can't help but think that he's not the first of my friends that's going to be there. I can't help but think, what if I was on that side? I can't help but think, when am I going to be called on by my God to face the same cost for the sake of faithfulness? And I have to empathize. I have to think about what his life is like. I have to think about what it's like for him to be away from his wife for years. For his oldest daughter to have gotten married while he's in prison. For his mother to have been buried last Monday while he's in prison. I think when I was a young Christian and I thought about persecution, I thought that there was some kind of magical power in the martyrs. You know, when I read the stories, for whatever folklore is a part of the early Christian martyr stories, and you hear of, you know, fires being quenched and the mouths of lions being stopped and these amazing things happening, and you see these people dying and you're only reading their testimonies, you're only reading the testimony of a church who went through this with this martyr, and you're hearing how powerful and how dynamic and how holy they were and the power with which they died, and they, you know, they make these scathing rebukes and they make these grand gestures of love to the people that are killing them and literally torturing them. And it's easy to confuse the notion of whether or not the martyrs are magical or graceful. Like, I kind of had this notion at one point that the persecuted martyrs, like, didn't feel pain. Like, God gave them some special power over their own life and power over their own death. But that's not the case. It hurts to be a martyr. And it hurts to burn at a stake. And it hurts to be in prison. And it's not, so a man dying, being burned at the stake for Jesus, and a man dying, being burned at the stake for being a witch, feel the same thing. But there's a grace in the martyr that's not an escape from pain. It's not an escape from life. It's something in them that's greater than the pain. To illustrate this, most of us know the story of Dirk Willems. How many of you know the story of Dirk Willems? I think just about everybody. So he's the man that goes back and gets he flees prison, he makes a ladder, escapes a tower. It's the winter in Holland, and he runs across the frozen lake, the frozen creek, river, I think it was. He makes it across, but the man that's pursuing him falls in the ice and screams, "Help, help." And rather than escaping, he turns around and goes back and pulls his captor out of the icy water. And that man was going to let him go, but the burgomaster rides up on his horse and says, "You took an oath, you have to arrest that man." Which he does. And Dirk Willems goes back to prison and is convicted of death. Now, but I don't know if you've ever read the whole story. On the day of Dirk Willems' death, there was an eastern wind that blew. And when you burn at the stake, it's smoke inhalation and asphyxiation that you die from. You're not supposed to die from flames. You're supposed to die from smoke. But the wind blew the flames away from him, and he was literally roasted to death. 70 times, and some reports said up to 2 miles away, they heard him screaming, "Lord Jesus, have mercy, Lord Jesus, have mercy." You see, there's no escape from the pain. But there's something in Dirk Willems that knows there's something more important than my pain. There's a cause greater than me that's worth this. It's not magical. It's not some kind of trickery with the natural world. It's just a persistence that's greater than the flesh. It's interesting when you study the causes of the martyrs, what men are willing to die and suffer for. You know, there were men who were burned at the stake in the Anabaptist revivals for refusing infant baptism. And I often ask this question to my Anabaptist friends. Imagine your life and your family, a change of political wind happens, and all of a sudden they're requiring you to get your baby wet. The state requires that they get your baby wet, or they're going to kill you. Now, you don't believe that's a baptism. You don't believe it's valid. You don't believe there's anything to it but a fallen system. Are you going to die at a stake telling the state you can't get my baby wet? That's literally what the Anabaptist revivals were founded on. I mean, it's the symptom that they're dealing with. It's the issue is a free will church, but the symptom where that all plays out is in this issue of infant baptism. And men would literally rather die than allow the state to baptize their children. And here's the ironic thing. In many cases, they're going to die at a stake, and then the state's going to take their children anyhow. And yet they die. They stand on the ground of truth and say, I will not bend. The same thing's happening in the early church when it was the custom in either the market or in some required obedience to prove who was subject to Caesar, they would require an offering. They would require the offering of incense to the bust of Caesar or some other pagan conscription, some other prescribed worship that all people had to do. And the saints would rather die than say Caesar is Lord and put a pinch of incense on the bust of Caesar in the market. And how easy would it be to justify that action? How easy would it be to say, my children are at home starving. If this is what I have to do to get food, if this is what we have to do to survive, there's nothing in it. I don't believe in it. I'm not worshiping him. But that was unacceptable. That was treasonous against their real Lord. And they would rather die. In Ken's case, he chose to refuse the state when they called him to testify. It's interesting to hear the transcript from the most recent case that he was in. They were convicting another man that was involved with what happened, and they wanted Ken to testify against the man that he had worked with. And Ken had refused. He had committed to not testify against anyone else in the situation. And when they called him into the court, I mean, he's a prisoner, so they just literally brought him in. And the prosecutor asked, the first question he asked was, did you live in Virginia during the year whatever? And he said, under the counsel of my attorney, I plead the fifth. I refuse to answer because I plead the fifth, something along those lines. And the judge says, you've been granted prosecutorial immunity. You can't plead the fifth. You need to understand that you cannot face any charges or any prosecution from anything that you'll say in this testimony. And he said, then according to the dictates of my faith and my conscience, I cannot answer your questions. Now this man, his testimony was literally immaterial to the case. An hour and a half of deliberation and the other man was convicted. How easy would it have been for him to say, they're going to convict him whether I say anything or not. Why should I suffer more? But there was a principle at hand. A principle that said, we did what's right. I'm not going to cooperate with unrighteousness, with evil. And I'm willing to pay for it. He has a cause greater than himself. I want to talk about a plan for persecution. How do we make ourselves ready? I mean, let's all be honest, we got it pretty easy. Nobody's beating down our door, nobody's threatening us, nobody's taking away our lands. Nobody's persecuting me. But that doesn't mean it's going to be that way next year. So if the time comes when this becomes common again, if my inclination is right, that Ken Miller is not the last person that's going to sit on the prisoner side of a glass partition among our people, then what do we do? How do we prepare ourselves for that kind of life? Here's some thoughts and ideas of how to plan for persecution. As an anecdote, you know, with one of the first modern stories of persecution I read was Richard Wurmbrand's Tortured for Christ. Have you guys read that? Richard Wurmbrand was, I think he was in Romania, and he was a preacher when the Iron Wall fell. And he spent, I think, 16 of 20 years in prison, in communist prisons for the faith. And he said that when he was a young man, he used to think about the martyrs and think about what he would do in their situation and how he would endure. And he felt like those thought experiments were preparatory for his life, that it prepared him to consider himself as someone who may have to face these struggles. He felt like that was helpful. That's not on my list, but he actually suffered for the faith, so he's worth listening to. It's an interesting book. If you haven't read it, I would recommend it. So that was, Richard Wurmbrand was the man that started Voice of the Martyrs, if you're familiar with that organization. There was an idea floating around in the 70s or 80s it was mostly from propaganda from the Eastern Bloc, that Christianity wasn't being persecuted in the Eastern Bloc. And Mr. Wurmbrand was an interesting caveat to that story. He was not non-resistant politically. He was a pro-Western capitalist coming out of the Eastern Bloc of communism. But in his real life, he was actually very, very non-resistant. He was in an underground prison for a long time. It was a horrible, like a sensory deprivation prison. It was much worse for him than the like pit prison that he had been in, where the guards wore slippers on their feet. There was only fluorescent lights. They went off and on at odd times. You never had any way of knowing what day it was or how long you'd been there. There was no sounds. It was a horrible, horrible experience. And the only way he kept his sanity during that time, and they would pull him out from time to time and beat him and torture him. The only way he kept his sanity, at least part of it, he had this routine that he would go through to keep some sense of time in a timeless place. And part of his routine was he thought about 2 hours a day thinking about what it would be like to be his persecutor, to sympathize with them, to understand why are they doing this, who are these men, where do they come from, what are their families like, what is happening in their life that puts them in this situation, how do we happen to be in the same room together. And it was his key to be able to identify with men who were persecuting him. So practically in his real life, aside from his doctrinal flaws, he was very non-resistant. He ended up testifying in the United States Congress. He famously, when someone said that there was no persecution of the Christians in the Eastern Bloc, and he removed his shirt and showed all of his stripes from beatings that he had received in prison. So he had thought about these things before he endured them. Now, I don't think that that should overtake us. I don't think that should be a source of grief. It should be a contemplation like Jesus on his cross. The martyrs in their way of life, it shouldn't rob us of our joy. It shouldn't make us fearful. It should be something that's a part of what it means to be a Christian. I mean, to identify with Jesus' cross in a very practical way. Here's my thoughts for planning for persecution. Surrender as a way of life. To look for opportunities in your day-to-day life to surrender. To surrender your rights, to surrender your will, to surrender what you want. Now let me give you a good barometer of how surrendered of a life you are. When you are frustrated, it's due to a lack of surrender. When you are frustrated, here, let me tell you what is happening. When you're frustrated, you have an expectation about what should be happening in your life. And the fact that it's not happening the way that you expect it to be happening is causing friction inside of you. And that manifests in all kinds of ugly ways. Frustration is the key indicator that you are not living a surrendered life. Frustration is the infringement of your rights. That kind of, you know, frustration happens in our homes, in our marriages, in our friendships, in our church life, on I-93, and especially on Starro Road. And those are the places to practice surrender. It is a form of self-mastery to overcome frustration. To say that I feel all this, and I'm not going to allow that to control me. I'm going to seek God for grace to deal with this in the right way. And sometimes frustrations catch you out of the corner of your eye when you're cut off. And sometimes they catch you out of the middle of something and something doesn't go right. But sometimes it's a way of life. Sometimes there's these things that every time they come up, they frustrate you. They make you agitated and angry and upset. And those places, especially those regular places, are the places that God wants to minister to us and teach us how to conform our character and to prepare our lives to not live for self. Our Father is a faithful Father, and if we're listening, and if we're willing, and if we're able, He will take us through a training ground. He has us in boot camp. You are being prepared as soldiers right now to suffer for the cross of Christ, and you can either accept that training or reject it. If you reject it, you're going to find a very difficult choice in front of you. If you accept God's training, you'll be prepared in the little things of life now to make huge decisions in the future. So dealing with frustration is part one of our plan for persecution. Part two is to use but not abuse this world. To learn how to operate in this world in that place of tension, of having access and opportunity and ability and not depending on those things. To use the world for good and not abuse it and consume it for our own selfish purposes. Paul views his citizenship this way. Paul's citizenship is not a way for him to get his life easier. Paul's citizenship is a way for him to accomplish the task that he knows God has called him to. Remember, all the way back, Jesus appears to Paul and says that you'll appear before, I forget how it says, but essentially before kings. He calls them the Gentiles and he says he's going to appear before kings. And that is the goal that Paul has set before his life. I'm going to serve the gospel, I'm going to serve my master, I'm going to be a debtor to the Gentiles, and I'm going to testify before kings. And that's exactly what happens in his life. And when we see Paul exercising his right as a citizen, it's not for the sake of making his life better, it's for the sake of advancing his ministry. So his appeal to Caesar is in line with his calling to testify before kings. These things go hand in hand. And we should view our opportunities, our civil opportunities, in the same light. But there's also other things that we have access to, our media, our technology, our money, and our resources. These are all opportunities that we have to use and not abuse. They're things that we have to learn to hold in tension. How are we going to use these things for good? Because they're here for us to use. I'll tell you that right now. The things that we're doing with media, with technology, with resources, with money, these things are for us to use to further our cause for our King. And we're not doing our job well if we're neglecting them. We can't just hermitize ourselves from the world. We can't just seal ourselves off and become recluse. We have to engage in the world around us. We have to know how to hold these things in tension and balance. And fighting through those tough decisions of where do we engage, where do we not? What do we use, what do we not? What do we reject, what do we accept? What do we buy, what do we not? How do we... All these are decisions that are just like our frustrations. They're training grounds to teach us how to use the world and not depend on it. How to have access to these things that are necessary to further the cause, but not be dependent on them for our safety, for our security, for our joy, for our whatever we need. We should limit our expectations when it comes to those things. So we have to deal with frustration. We have to learn how to use but not abuse the world. We have to yield to the powers that be. Turn to 2 Peter. Here's a very interesting thing. Turn to 2 Peter. I don't know how many of you have noticed this before. 5. It's almost 6. I'll try to hurry. 2 Peter. 2 Peter 2, verse 4. Okay, stay with me. I'm going to read quick because I want to get through. I'm going to read all the way up to 22, but there's some important things, so pay close attention as I read. 2 Peter 2 and verse 4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved into judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, men, notice that, Sodom and Gomorrah, into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an ensample unto those that after should live ungodly, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them and seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to preserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Presumptuous are they, self-willed. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. Whereas angels, which are greater in power and might, bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord. Notice there that the them applies to both the dignities and what he's talking about with the angels. Same them. 12. But these as natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed speak evil of things they understand not and shall utterly perish in their own corruptions and shall receive the reward of unrighteousness as they that count it pleasure to riot in the daytime, spots they are and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you, having eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sins, beguiling unstable souls and heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness, but was rebuked for his iniquity. The dumb ass speaking with a man's voice forbade the madness of the prophet. These are wells without water, clouds that are carried with the tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. For when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lusts of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption, for of whom a man is overcome, of the same as he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb that the dog is turned to his own vomit again and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. Now flip over to Jude. I'm going to start reading Jude chapter 5. Now notice all the similarities between these two passages. There's some amazing similarities. 2 Peter, we just read, now we'll read Jude chapter 5, chapter 1, verse 5. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people, he starts at the same place about being saved out of things, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not, and the angels which kept not their first estate, just like Peter, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. Now he mentions Sodom. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Likewise also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael, the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. But these speak evil of those things which they know not, just like Peter said. But what they know naturally as brute beasts, same terminology, in those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, and ran greedily, just like Balaam, after the error of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsayings of Korah. These are spots in your feast of charity when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of winds. Trees whose fruit withereth without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. And Enoch, also the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lusts, and their mouths speak great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of vantage. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time who should walk after their own godly lusts. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. There's some amazing similarities. One of those guys almost seems like he's quoting the other. There's some amazing correlations between those two passages of Scripture. Now, what's interesting to me, aside from all the similarities, is that what both of them mention is that the notions of Gomorrah and those the angels in Peter, he mentions the deluge, and then Gomorrah, Sodom and Gomorrah, are connected with this notion. There's a simile between all those rebellious actions, rebellious against God, and those that speak evil of dignities, not knowing what they're talking about. Now that's very interesting to me, and I spent a long time today thinking, what is the connection? What is the correlation between speaking evil of dignities in the present world, the same dignities that are also whoever's fighting with Michael, this structure over the world, and being rebellious against God? There's some connection between these rebellious actions and not recognizing the power, the powers that be, that are not necessarily connected to God. Now, there's a whole huge, you know, theological, philosophical conversation we could have about that, and I think there's some really involved and intricate things that we could talk about that. But what's at the core of it, I think, is that we, as God's people, recognize order. I tire of people talking about organized religion. Oh, I love God, but I don't like organized religion. As if the God who created the atom and physics and light is somehow disorganized. It's absurd. Of course, whatever religion there is that belongs to the truth of God is organized. just like I'm organized. I mean, imagine if I didn't have organization in my body and my cells didn't know what to do or where to go. It would be ridiculous. But from the very principles of creation, we learn order, that there's an order to be had. And God has established the world. He has framed the world in order. The sun rises, the sun sets, the seasons come, the seasons go. The tree, the seed falls to the ground and bears fruit after its own kind. These are immutable physical and spiritual laws. Immutable. Never change before, never change after. You reap what you sow is an eternal principle. So we recognize all this order. And there is a temporal order. The speed limits, the taxes, the military engagements, the kingdoms of men fighting with each other, the laws for how to live, all of these things are an order. In every place they were, and I've explained this before in our teaching about why we don't vote, in our teaching about non-resistance, that whatever power there is, whether it's Nebuchadnezzar or Pharaoh or Hitler or Mao or Saddam Hussein or George Bush or Winston Churchill, the one thing in common with all of those structures is that every single one of them is attempting to preserve a social order. I don't care if you live in Pharaoh's Egypt, or Hitler's Germany, or Mao's China, or Bush's America, or whoever, wherever you have lived under a civil structure, it has imposed certain universal things. You can't steal from the market, you can't beat up somebody walking down the street, you can't rape women indiscriminately, but all these, they all have varied. They all have different applications for different times and different places, but in every instance, they're establishing a social order. They're making a society. And we can talk a lot more about that. We have already. But if you have any questions about that, I would love to talk about that principle. It's a grand principle of understanding Romans 13 in contrast with Matthew 5. But there's an order to be had. And recognizing that order for what it is and our place in it as strangers and pilgrims, as sojourners, not as participants, but as sojourners, is an important part of what makes God's people who we are and the place that we are. It's an important piece of the ministry that we have to offer to the world around us. Because let me just talk about me. If I followed my rebellious proclivities, I would rebel against the state just to be a rebel. But that's not what I'm called to do. I'm called to submit. I have no quarrel with the system as it is. Have you ever wondered why Paul doesn't speak out against slavery? It's a big question. It's a very big question. Why does he establish the civil order as it is? Why does he talk about the slave as God's freeman and the master as God, as a bondservant to Christ? Because his intention, it's not a vindication of the barbarity of slavery and its institutions. It's him saying, we are not upsetting the social order, we're making a new social order in the church. They do whatever they do. Leave their institutions alone. Here we have a different way. Here the slave and the master don't treat each other like that. Here we have a whole different premise. Here we are a different people, a different society, a different nation, but only here. Out there, remember when Peter is sent to cast a hook and take the fish and get the coin to pay the taxes? It's interesting, when you ask people their take on that story, what Jesus' message is, people have very different readings of that. I find two opposite conclusions from that same text. What Jesus says is that he asked the rhetorical question to Peter, who do men make pay taxes? Does a king make his son pay the taxes or the people that are subject to him? The rhetorical answer is obviously the people that are subject. And Jesus answers him, we're not subject to any of these people. We're not subject to them. We're the people of God. Nevertheless, so that we don't offend, go put a hook in the water, take out the fish, you'll have a coin, pay the tax. Not because we owe it, but because we have a job that is hindered by not going along with the social order where we can. So they pay the tax, they submit to the laws, they're gentle in the land. They have no quarrel with society except where we're talking about allegiance. Except where like I think Ken's case is instructive in this way, except where this order is in contrast to the natural order or the spiritual order. So God has an order that supersedes all things, and then men have their workings. That's a lot more than I want to talk about. That's a whole message in and of itself. But I wanted to lay out the point that we're supposed to establish the powers that be and submit ourselves to them in every place that we can. We're supposed to be good citizens of whatever nation we happen to be working in, whatever nation we come from or whatever nation we go to. And there's some subtle ways that we're, especially here, we allow ourselves these indulgences. I do. I struggle with it all the time. Now, I work with permit departments to pull permits for work, and it is frustrating. Frustrating to deal with building departments. Because I have a job to do, and I have work to do, and your rules are dumb. That's what I think. But that's not right. They have rules for a reason. And whether I like them or not, whether they make sense to me or not, whether I would do them that way or not, is none, literally none of my business. I have to pay $30 to the city every year for every car that I own. And I can either grumble and complain about that, or accept and recognize the powers that be and say, this is the way it is. I'm not chafing against that. I'm not fighting against that. I'm not trying to get out of that. I'm not trying to escape that. I'm here. I want to be a good citizen. I want to be good to my neighbors. I want to be good to the government. I want to be good to the police. All of these things are the status quo that allows society to continue on. Whether it's a piece of it that I agree with or not, the status quo that keeps society moving, that the traffic moves and there's not, you know, serial killers running around, all these things are an important part of why God ordained civil structures to keep society intact. And we have an obligation under our king to be good ambassadors here and to not make trouble unless there's a cause to make trouble over. Unless there's something directly contradictory between what my king has said and what this current nation has said. And respecting those powers that be, now here's how this plays out. When I watched Ken Miller's sentencing, the judge in his original sentencing was ashamed to sentence him. He talked about what a good man he was, what an honorable man he was, about how honorable and respectful he had been to the court. And I know, and I have talked with Ken, and he has a real respect for the powers that be. And he's had to walk this really difficult tightrope between saying, I respect the court, I respect your laws, I'm giving you all the honor that is due to you, but I cannot and will not obey you. And that message speaks so much louder. It has been so convicting to me, because if I was in his shoes, I would be so inclined to rebuke the court, to rebuke the judge, to rebuke the powers that be, to challenge the system. But he's walked a holy line, and he said, I respect the judge. I honor the system. I respect the law. But right here is the place that I cannot go along. And because he's fixed the point and said, I'll honor you in every other way but this one, it clarifies the issue for everyone that sees. And to the point that the judge in his sentencing, where he's rebelling against the law, says, I recognize what a good and a humble and a holy man you are, but you've broken the law and I have to do this. And it clarifies the issue. We're not talking about a man who is just a rebel to be a rebel. We're not talking about some loose cannon. We're not talking about some wild man that has his own law and his own way. It has perfectly crystallized and galvanized exactly what the issue is. And there's no misunderstanding. Here's the problem. Here's where I will stand against you. Everywhere else, I will submit. And that's an important position that the persecuted faithful people have done. Yield to the powers that be. So practically, I think most immediately, complaining and grumbling about laws and taxes are exactly the place we should practice that with each other in our own lives. Another plan for persecution is to learn to get over hurt and offense. You know, it's interesting, in Mr. Yun's book, who was a Chinese persecuted brother, and in Mr. Wernbrand's book, the hardest thing was not the persecution of the world, it was the lack of support in the church. And I think there's an expectation that if we suffer for righteousness, that all the church will stand up and applaud us and cheer for us. And that's not often the case. Like Paul talks about in Timothy, everyone's left me, no man stood with me. And even in the Anabaptist circles where Brother Ken is from, many people don't support what he's done. In many cases, he stands alone. And that's, I think, designed in part by the devil to cause those few that have the heart and the will to suffer persecution for God to dishearten them and to say, even your own people have left you. You miserable, wretched, cast out soul. And if we're willing to suffer persecution, but we allow those hurts and offenses to smother us, we'll end up having suffered and out of the way. We have to remember, and the little hurts and offenses in our lives, learning how to get over those things are essential to our power and our ability to suffer persecution. 2 Timothy again, 2 Timothy 3 and 4 there are incredible places to go and learn reconciliation with John Mark and his dealing with things and being left alone and still having the confidence that I have finished my course and there's a crown laid up for me in heaven. The fact that Paul has been isolated and rejected and left alone has not taken his joy and confidence in the crown that he has in God. I think if we're going to plan for persecution, we have to live life with open hands. That our peace and our joy has to come from immaterial things. That our lives cannot consist in the abundance of the things which we possess. That what it means to be a Christian and to have joy and to have peace is irrespective of the possessions or the things or the freedom that I have. And learning how to be both abased and abound is an important piece of that. To know how to be content in every state of life. That as the people of God, whatever our lot is, whether we're sick or healthy, whether we're rich or poor, whether we're free or bound, wherever we are, we ought to be able to bring peace and joy with us because these are internal things that come from God, not from our surroundings. And this is the way in which a saint of God can be persecuted, tortured, imprisoned, and cast out, destitute and alone, miserable and in pain, and have joy. Because we know that they do. In many cases in history, we have the example of men who are suffering unimaginable pain and have joy and have peace. So it must be the case that their peace and their joy is not contingent on their physical situation. That's the mastery over the, that's the grace part Not the magic that makes the pain go away, the grace that gives us something greater than the pain to live for and to die for. You know, living life with open hands is willingly surrendering, not fighting for things. Living with open hands is agreeing with our adversary quickly. Someone comes against me, I let it go. Remember, Jesus said that. That's just as important as loving your enemies. Agree with thine adversary quickly whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver the officer, and thou be cast into prison. For verily I say unto you, thou shalt not come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. There's a principle in the kingdom that when somebody comes to fight against us, wherever we can let it go, we let it go. Even where we can't let it go, we still let it go. Even when it means continuing to resist, we let everything go. We let our bitterness go. We let our offense go. We let our possessions go. We let our security go. We let it go. We have opportunity in our regular life to practice those things. You know, along with practicing contentment, which is my last point, I threw it in there with, so let's go back over. Deal with your frustration. Use but not abuse the world. Yield to the powers that be. Learn to get over offense. Live life with open hands. And practice contentment. Godliness with contentment is great gain, the Bible says. And there's a lot of different ways that contentment affects us. Contentment is about our possessions and our things. It is about our station of life and our environment. To be okay with the things that we have and to not be coveting after other things that we don't have is definitely a huge part of contentment. There's another part of contentment that I think sometimes we forget about and we miss, and it's this. To be content is to feel like I'm in the center of God's will. It's not just about not wanting things that I don't have. It's also about, this is the right place for me. This is where I'm supposed to be. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. That's what Paul is answering from prison in Rome. He's answering with contentment. I'm content to be here. I'm content to lay down my life. I'm content because I have done what I'm supposed to do. And my contentment is rooted not just in that my okayness with the situation as it is, but my contentment is grounded in feeling fulfilled in who I am in God. What does that mean? That means that I am doing the things that I'm supposed to be doing. Like, that's such a simple thing. To be able to go to bed at night and say to God, I did what I was supposed to do. I was in the place where I belonged. I was fulfilling my function. That is the source of contentment, and that goes wherever you go. Now, how do you do that? You find fulfillment in where your proper place is. You find fulfillment in the ministries that God has ordained for you. When I think of contentment, I think of the Christian ministry of our wives and the mothers of our children. Our wives and the mothers in the church, mothers in Zion, teach us so many things about the ministry of Christ because, well, for a lot of reasons. But in this regard, we're asking someone, God's asking someone, to be content with this, what we consider often menial task labor, to find fulfillment in this, to find fulfillment in the housework and the drudgery and the teaching. And you know what's astounding to me about Christian wives and mothers? You know, in Proverbs 31, it says that her husband shall be known in the gates. It doesn't say that the virtuous woman will be known in the gates. It says her husband will be known in the gates. She's sacrificing even the acknowledgement for virtue to someone else. She's content for her husband to be known in the gates. She's content to be in the place back at home. She's content to be with the children. She's content to be doing the things that she's been ordained to do. She finds contentment in those things. And that's an example for how we should learn contentment. Because there's a place, so I know with all the stresses of life that are in that abound in our women, the difficulties that they have to face and the trials that they suffer, there's two ways to approach that. They're struggling and chafing with it, or there's finding peace and contentment in it. And it's really a lot about attitude and perseverance and virtuous things. But when our sisters are in their place, when they're content with their ministry, they radiate, they have peace, they have joy. And it's the same thing with all of us. Wherever we find our calling and our purpose in life, when we're working in that and doing that, it brings contentment. You know, we're here every single week. Almost every single week. And we're here and we have this meeting and somebody comes up here and preaches and everybody listens and whatever happens here happens here. But you know, and we've talked about from time to time among the brothers, you know, it's difficult sometimes to have to preach and the responsibilities are heavy and all this. And I get weighed down with those sometimes, but you know who never has a Sunday off? Is the Hornings. Week after week after week after week after week after week, we meet in their house. We mess up their living room. We stain their floors. We do all this in here, and week after week after week, they operate in their calling. And they have grace, and that doesn't mean they have to never say anything's wrong or change anything or modify anything, but it means that they have their operating, they have this ministry that all of us are benefited from. And nobody even thinks about it. We just keep going. I mean, not nobody, not ever, but very commonly, it's not what we're thinking about when we're here on Sunday. That this is costing somebody every single week. And that's a picture of contentment. Of this is what I'm doing for God. And it brings me peace. And it brings people good. And I'm fulfilled. You have a ministry like that. You have something that you're supposed to be doing like that. Something that's supposed to bring you contentment and peace. Something that you take with you wherever you go. Something that you're continually doing for God as a ministry and a service and a form of worship to God with your life. There's something you're supposed to be doing like that. And if you don't know what that is, please, please figure it out. Because you won't be content until you have the place where you can plant your feet and say, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. This is the work for me. This is what brings me fulfillment. This is what makes me whole. All right. I think that's everything I have to say. Let's. Why don't we all stand and give thanks, and then Brother Dan can have a song. Yeah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the example of the apostles, especially. We thank you for Paul and his life, and Peter and his words and life, and Jude. Father, we thank you for the holy men that have gone before, the cloud of witnesses. We pray, Father, that you would find us faithful as well. Father, we don't know what lies ahead of us. And we're not going to worry about those things. What we're going to busy ourselves about, Father, is today we want to be faithful. Tomorrow when we wake up, tomorrow we want to be faithful. We pray, Father, that you would give us grace a day at a time to do what we're supposed to do, to be who we were supposed to be. We pray, Father, for daily bread, that you would meet our needs and make us who you want us to be. We pray, Father, that you would use our life today to prepare any of us and all of us who will suffer persecution. We pray that you'd make us a ready people, a faithful people, a holy people. And Father, we pray for those that are bound in prison now. We pray for our brother Ken and his struggle. We pray that you'd give him peace and comfort, even right now, to know that the church is praying for him and lifting him up before your throne and remembering him in bonds. And we pray for many, many others that we don't know, Father, who we know that the church is suffering in many parts of the world. We pray for our brothers and sisters. We pray that you would connect us intimately with their grief and their pain like we do with Christ's, because it is Christ's. Father, we pray you bless your church. Give us strength to stand in this day. In Jesus' name, amen.